And welcome to Stateside. I'm Cynthia Canty, and we are so happy to be here in Flint on this beautiful evening and in the beautiful Flint Institute of Arts. What a beautiful space for us to be here. And for all of us, it's such a treat to look out and see you. Let me explain. When we do Stateside, we spend all day, our office and the studio, no windows. And it's just us. And what a charge to look out and see human beings. So it's wonderful. Thank you so much for being with us tonight for Stateside. We have a lot of interesting things to talk about, people to meet, so let's just get started. Who were the ones most vulnerable to lead poisoning in this city? Of course, it's the children. So we wanted to check in on the Flint Community School District and talk about how they're preparing for the challenge. And for that, it's a pleasure to welcome the school superintendent here in Flint, Bill Altawab. Thank you so much for being with us tonight on Stateside.
Thanks for having me.
So after all that you have been through, how would you describe the state of the Flint Community School District right now as we talk?
We're moving forward. That's key. We're moving forward. Right now, we are putting systems in place so that we're able to meet the needs of all of our children. We're sort of dealing with an unknown. We don't truly know what will be the full impact of the water crisis, but we must be proactive. We must be ready to respond to all of our students' needs. So we really are focused on aligning our resources to best meet the needs of all of our children.
How would you say the children and their families are doing?
I would say that our children are remaining focused because our leaders and our teachers are remaining focused. I will say that I attended the town hall meeting this past week, and I was reminded that we're still a community that's hurting. There's still a long way to go, but I truly believe as it relates to children, it's really up to us as the adults to protect them, to keep them focused, to let them know they'll be okay. And that is our message to our children.
Setting the tone.
Exactly.
Setting the tone. How about the water in the schools? Are you using it?
No. So I would say today that all of our students are still receiving bottled water. I do want to thank the huge donations we received, not only locally, but across the state and across the nation. We have this huge donation from the Walmart Foundation, and they've been covering all of our libation needs. They make sure that water is delivered to each school weekly, and we will continue that effort until we see there's time to move in a different direction. Also, as it relates to preparing our kids' lunches, Sodexo Magic has put a system in place where our students' lunches are prepared with safe water.
So the trust factor is, it needs a lot of rebuilding.
Most definitely.
Understatement. You had mentioned in the past, Bilal, when you were talking about the impact of the water situation, you wanted to see more early childhood options from 0 to 5 years old. What's happening on that front?
Now, that has been a wonderful sort of byproduct of this piece. As you may know, we reopened a closed school, Cummings, thanks to the support of multiple partners, one being the C.S. Mott Foundation in partnership with U of M Flint. And so now we are servicing kids over there, kids ages 0 to 4, 0 to 5. Also, you may know that the Mott Foundation is supporting the building of a new early childhood center on one of our campuses. Actually, we'll have an educator center opening here in November. Also, in partnership with the ISD, we're constantly increasing the number of early childhood opportunities in the city of Flint. My concern is that right now we're only tapping into about 40% of the children who could be in an early childhood option. So it's going to really take a community effort to tap into that additional 60% that we want to see in a classroom.
So that's kind of the challenge ahead.
That is a challenge, and that's beyond Flint Community Schools. Like I said, that is a community effort. There are so many children who are just at home who really need to be in an early childhood option.
Is the space there?
The space is there.
So you're saying
the space that we have no limitations. Come one, come all.
That's
but we want to make sure that all of our children are set up for success.
And you've also talked a lot about bringing in more behavioral support staff and increase in specialists like social workers and psychologists and speech pathologists. Where are you with that?
Yes, and so I do want to thank folks at the state level and also folks at the federal level who provided funding for additional social workers, counselors, speech pathologists, school psychologists, and the district. I would say my greatest, not greatest challenge, but I would say the piece that sort of keeps me up at night as superintendent mm-hmm. is the sustainability piece. You know, just how long will these resources, you know, how long will they be coming or be provided for the district? Because like I said, we're dealing with an unknown, you know, and so I really want to know there's a commitment for years to come for these resources. And I will say another challenge for us is, you know, now we have maybe some may say a good problem to have, just filling the positions now, you know, finding the talent to come to the district. So we have the positions, we have the funding, now it's all about filling those positions and that sustainability piece.
Overall, Bilal, how would you characterize the support that you've gotten from Lansing, from state officials and from the legislature?
Well, I would say that that support has been great. I do want to go back. The Cummings piece, there's a lot of state support in the reopening of Cummings. And so I do want to thank our lieutenant governor who played a major role, our state superintendent who has played a major role in that work. So I would say right now the support is great, but my biggest question is now the sustainability piece, the long-term commitment.
Keeping the money coming.
Yes, indeed.
Because we're really looking at an unknown that's going to stretch into who knows how many years.
Exactly. And folks ask me, you know, what are you seeing? One thing I will say, we have a huge influx of parents now who are requesting that their child is evaluated. And so we're definitely meeting that need. But like you stated, the long-term piece is truly an unknown for us.
You have some fierce competition in the Flint area from charters and from open enrollment. How do you sell Flint Community Schools? What's your pitch?
I want to say this. So you're right. There are about 15,000 school-age kids in the city of Flint. We only have a third of that market share, about 5,000. We have about 5,000 who are currently in charters, about 5,000 who have taken advantage of schools of choice. So yeah, we need to sell ourselves. Right now, our focus is on controlling the narrative. And so we're constantly pushing out positive stories. There's so many great things that are occurring in the school district. But one thing I will say, I just don't want to sell you something. I want you to be able to come into Flint Community Schools and truly see all the great things that we're doing. We're expanding athletics now. We're expanding art opportunities for our kids. And we have a laser-like focus on academics, and that is key. And I will say this. Flint Community Schools will have the system in place that will meet the needs of all kids. And so we're number one. We're going to be number one. I feel as if we're sort of awakening a sleeping giant. I mean, Flint Community Schools has a very storied past. And so I'm really happy to be leading this next chapter in Flint Community Schools.
Even as you're staring at the ceiling at night, just saying, worrying about sustaining all of the momentum and the money.
Yes.
Big
yes.
challenge there.
Big challenge.
You do have one of the most challenging jobs of any school superintendent in the nation. I don't think anyone would argue with that. Well, just when you think about all of this, what gives you hope and optimism?
You know, I would say this. I, as superintendent, I do not feel as if I'm alone in this work. I have a community behind the school district. We have the strong philanthropic organizations here. We have the universities. We have the community who really wants to see this district return to its greatness. So I would say when I'm having a long day, and there are many of those, I do feel as if I can call someone and say, you know, I need some help here. Can you help? And folks are willing to respond. And so that is what keeps me encouraged. And at the end of the day, I will always say this. There are children here. And we have to do what's right for children. And so that drives the work. And to know I have a community behind me, that keeps me encouraged.
Bilal Tawab is the superintendent of Flint Schools. Thank you so much for being with us here on Stateside here in Flint. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.